everyone. Welcome to our lesson study online. This week, we have been studying lesson 2, April 4 to 10, the origin and nature of the Bible. And tonight is Wednesday, April 8. The study is entitled, The Parallel Between Christ and Scripture. Shall we bow our heads? Father in heaven, right now we pause for a while because we need you to help us understand your word. Beyond our comprehension, we are finite, we are limited. And so we ask you by your spirit to enlighten our thoughts. For we pray in Jesus' name, Amen. The parallel between Christ and Scripture. We have several texts, John 1:14, John 2:22, John 8:31-32, and John 17:17. I will read only one verse, John 1:14, and I leave the rest to you. Read it by yourself as you study tonight. May I remind you that this video is only a support for you to understand the topic. The major task rests in you. Dig deep into the words of God. And so John 1:14 says, And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. And you see the word that refers to Jesus Christ. By the way, the text earlier in verses 1 to 3, in the beginning it says, was the word, refers to the spoken word of the Creator when He created the world by His word. And John introduced that word that was spoken there, and who spoke there was with God, and that word is Christ. He became flesh and dwelt among us. That is the concept of the incarnation. God, being spiritual, came into human flesh. Okay, so our study tonight is entitled The Parallel Between Christ and the Scriptures. So here I provide you parallel lines, the red ones and the blue ones. The red ones actually descriptions of Jesus Christ, and the blue one are descriptions of the Bible, parallel, or they have almost similar characteristics. Number one, according to our study, Jesus, being of divine character, of divine nature, came into this world. We know that Jesus is the second person of the Godhead, equal in nature, equal in power with the Father. But because of the love for man, the divine council decided that the Creator Himself, Jesus Christ, would take the human form. And so the plan was carried out. The one responsible in making or preparing the body of the Savior was none other than the Holy Spirit. You see there the second box. Okay, Luke 1:35. The Holy Spirit was responsible in preparing the human body of the Savior, Jesus Christ. In the same manner, the Bible was also of divine nature. 2 Timothy 3:16-17. All Scripture is divine breath in. Okay, it was inspired by God. God was the source. He is the author of the messages of the Scriptures. That's why they have similar parallel nature. Comes from God. They are of divine nature. The Holy Spirit was also responsible in the production of the Scriptures, the written word of God. He was the one who moved this holy man of God who wrote the Scriptures. And we call that process inspiration. According to our study, Jesus, who is omnipresent, present everywhere because He is of divine origin, was actually born in a specific time and also a specific place in Middle East. And that is a problem actually. God, who is present everywhere, have decided to be in one particular place with a body. You see, that's the problem of a human body. We are confined in a place. We cannot be both in one place and in the other place at the same time. But our lesson is telling us that despite the fact that Jesus was born in a particular time, He is not limited in time. His life, His teachings, His message is beyond His time. It includes all the time, so long as we are here on planet Earth. Place, yes. He was born in a particular place, Bethlehem, but His teachings, His ministries, and the scope of His message is not limited to that particular place in Middle East. And of course, yes, we agree that Jesus was born in a particular culture, but His message, His ministry is not limited to that culture. It transcends all other culture. The same with the Bible. The Bible was written in a particular time. According to our earlier study, it took 1,500 years to complete the whole writing of the Bible. And also, the Bible was written from specific places. And we have studied that in previous studies. But the message of the Bible is not limited in that particular time in the past, neither in that particular place in Middle East. And of course, the Bible carries with it the particular culture of that place, of that people, writers, and of that time. But the culture of the Bible transcends all other culture in a way that the Word of God is relevant to all people, at all times, anywhere. That's the beauty. The same, almost similar with Jesus Christ and the Bible. So that's why it's called the parallel between Christ and Scripture. The last there is, Jesus was given by the Holy Spirit a human body. And when we talk about human body, it has limitations. In other words, it has infirmities. It has its own weakness, our human body. And there are so many issues here that even the church is divided. Example, what was the human nature the Holy Spirit used for the human body of Christ? Was it the pre-fall or the post-fall? Was it sinful? Or there are issues, but I will not dwell on the issues here because there are other good points I want to share with you. Okay, so here in another line, the Bible has also human limitations because the language used to communicate the message or divine message of God used actually human language. And as far as language is concerned, there is no such thing as perfect language. You see, there are limitations in a language. That's why you will see that expressions of ideas from one language or language differs to another. See, so God with human body has limitations. It has its infirmities or weaknesses. But in spite of the human limitations, Jesus remains sinless. That's the good news. The body was like ours in the likeness of men, according to Paul, but He remained sinless. That is the good news. And that's the uniqueness of the body of Christ. That's why it's called the only begotten. Okay? Unique of its kind. No other human being just like Jesus Christ. He is 100% divine and 100% human. But He was sinless. The Bible has also its so many limitations. And we will go into details when we come to specific hermeneutical principles, how we understand that. You know, when I studied our topic tonight, what's the point of comparison? So what if Jesus and the Bible are parallel or almost similar in it? I need some answers to my question that I need to do tonight. So what? Ay, ano ngayon kung magkaparehas si Jesus at ang Bible? What is that to do with me tonight? What is this study topic tonight telling me to do? And so I dig a little deeper. I do a little search using the spirit of prophecy. Again, may I remind you need the spirit of prophecy that would comment on the Bible. And I want to share with you 4 passages related to our topic tonight that broadens my understanding, that gives me implications what to do tonight, and how this topic tonight relates with COVID-19. That's what I'm interested in. So here, the first one is this, Manuscript 124, 1903, which can also be found in Bible Commentary, Volume 6, page 1079. It is impossible for human mind to exhaust even one truth or one promise of the Bible. You see, here in this statement, Ellen White was saying, Jesus and the Bible of divine origin cannot be exhausted, cannot be fathomed, cannot be fully understood by a finite human being like me approaching the Bible. You see, one catches the glory from one point of view, another from another point, yet we can discern only gleamings, you see, We can see, study the Word of God from many directions, but we get only gleamings, very small amount of knowledge or understanding, because the origin of that book is not human. You know, human beings cannot fully explain the divine beings. Because if that happens, then God ceases to be God. You know, I remember I met a professor, not a Christian. I won't mention the religion for ethical purposes. And he said, you know, our Bible, not their Bible, the religious book, not the Bible, he was saying that the religious book is very simple, can be understood by a simple human being. But your Bible is so complicated. You know, I told him, you know, sir, if your God can be explained by your book written by human being, then your God ceases to be God. You see, we human beings with finite, limited mind cannot explain the infinite mind of God. And that is the mark of the Word of God as being of divine origin. The full radiance is beyond our vision, you see. As we contemplate the great things of God's Word, we look into a fountain that broadens and deepens beneath our gaze. Its breadth, its depth past our knowledge. As we gaze, the vision widens, stretched out before us. We behold a boundless, shoreless sea. You see there, when we read the Bible written by divine thought or mind, it's compared to a sea without a limit. You see, I often visit, and here in Orquita, we live very near to the seashore. And when you pick up, you know, a handful of sands, and imagine how many sands there, compare it with all the number of sands around the world, we can just think of the power of God. And you see, that's exactly almost the same with the Word of God. We cannot totally fathom the concepts of God. And this is what Ellen White said, impossible for any human mind to exhaust. Why? The Bible is of divine origin. We cannot, as limited, finite mind, can truly comprehend. Some more. Ellen White said, Testimonies for the Church, Volume 1, page 377. Some passages of the Scriptures are placed beyond the reach of human mind. You see there? So there are portions of the Scriptures here that God does not want people to understand because it is reserved in a specific point in time. Some passages are placed beyond the reach of human minds. In other words, we cannot explain that anymore. That is mystery. And if we explain mystery, it's no longer mystery. God has hidden it to human minds until such time as God chooses in His own wisdom to open them. You see, there are portions of the Scriptures that now we cannot understand, but in God's own time, He would reveal the understanding or the message of that particular passage in time. Wow! So, don't ask me questions. There are things there in the Bible I cannot explain because God has not revealed yet the meaning of that. Another one, Gospel Workers 312. Yet other passages of Scripture will never be perfectly comprehended until in the future life Christ shall explain them. That's why in other writings of Ellen White says, in heaven, in new heavens, in new earth, we will continue to study God's Word, especially the science of redemption. Wow, I ask, what is in it that we don't understand so many things? Why would God die when He can save using His power? And so on and so forth. Throughout the ceaseless ages of eternity, I quote, we will continue to study the Word of God in the science of redemption. This is the unsearchable mysteries. You see, mysteries cannot be explained by human mind. Then you have the unsearchable. Two words that gives us the idea our minds cannot comprehend, understand some passages of the Scriptures because it is of divine origin. See, that was not created, manufactured by the prophets. You see, it comes from God. The concept is beyond our understanding. The unsearchable mysteries in the plan of redemption, which finite minds cannot comprehend. A long time of prayer, a long lifetime of prayer and research will leave much unexplored and unexplained, what we know not now will be revealed hereafter. You see, this passage is telling us that even if we spend all throughout our life praying and researching for the meaning of the Word of God, we cannot explore it totally. There remains much unexplained. In other words, we cannot totally exhaust it. We cannot truly comprehend the depth of the words of God because our mind is limited. You see, so what's the point of comparison? Yes, it's telling us when we approach the Bible with a limited mind and searching on the scriptures of divine origin, then this will be our attitude. Psalms 25 verse 9. The meek will he teach his ways. In other words, if we approach the divine word of God with limited mind, if we have that meek attitude, he will teach us, he will give us understanding. Again, I did a little word study, just like what I have shown you last night, and then it gives me a richer meaning. Not everything, but just enough for us to understand and appreciate the beauty of God's Word. So we are interested of the word meek, because Psalms 25:9, David said, the meek is a people actually, he will teach his ways. He will help us understand the mysteries of the Bible. And this is what it means. So I type the word or the text or the word lexicon of Psalms 25 verse 9. And this is how it looks like, okay? So you have there the original word, okay? And here is the pronunciation, okay? Aunav, that's how it is pronounced, okay? The original word is there, this one. This is the transliteration, the pronunciation, aunav, in the Hebrew. The language is Hebrew, and part of the speech is said, noun, masculine. So the word meek is noun, masculine. The meek, he will teach his ways, you see. And I look at the meaning. Here is the meaning of this word, aunav. See there the short definition? You have also there the detailed definition. The short definition says, aunav, or meek, people who are meek, is described as depressed, figuratively, comma, in mind. This word means gentle or circumstances, in close parentheses, needy. I want to choose for our study the word needy, lacking the necessities of life. So when we approach the divine word of God, we should have the attitude of being in need, lacking the wisdom to understand the word of God. That must be our attitude, in contrast to the attitude of being proud that you don't need a wisdom, that your knowledge, your intelligence is enough, more than enough to understand God's word. No, you will never come to comprehend that. If that is our attitude, the Bible tells us we must possess such a mixed spirit, because when we have that spirit of being in need of wisdom, lacking understanding, then the Lord will teach his ways. You see, now let me reflect further on this with the needs of the time. I put there the question, meek or needy of what? That's the question I ask whenever I study the Bible to apply this concept in my life in the present situation. That question. God wants the meek to approach the Bible with the attitude of in need of wisdom, in need of deeper understanding. So now I apply that to the Bible. I study that with the need for more and deeper understanding. But I want to broaden it some more to include the circumstances we are in. So I ask this question, should I be meek or needy of what? Number one, and this should be the subject of our prayer, and we will do a little processing. Number one, need of protection from COVID-19. When you say protection, preventive. You see, we need masks, face masks. Here we can no longer buy the good quality. We have no more alcohol available from the drug stores, you see. But these are gadgets needed to prevent us from contamination or infection. See, that attitude of being in need. God wanted that one. Lord, please give us, protect us, you see. Preventive protection from COVID-19. Another need that I have listed there is need for healing from COVID-19. Those people who have been contaminated, let's pray that the Lord will cure or heal them. That's beyond what we can do, because there are no available drugs to kill the virus. But I pray that our health experts will be able to discover medicine for this. Another one is need for food supply until April 3rd. I've listened to the news and I understood, if I'm not mistaken, the government has extended the period of lockdown until April 30, something like that. And so we need additional food supply. At this juncture, I'd like to thank our government, to our barangay officials. The other day or yesterday, we received food supply. Okay, a bag of rice, 5 kilo rice, and canned goods, and noodles. Praise the Lord, we are happy for the support of the government. And we need some more because it is extended until April 30. We need food supply for all our people or fellow countrymen. And the number for there, put there all your personal needs. I don't know your needs, but I'm sure you have your needs, okay? Whatever is there, put it there, and we will include them in our prayer tonight. And then the last one is the meek, the needy should also need and highly need the Word of God this time. The need of the Bible there. And for processing, I put there 5 options to choose from. Okay, number one, I do not need the Bible. If that is your option, therefore you are not meek. You are not needy. You are proud. Being proud, you see, is an attitude that cannot exist in the presence of God. You are very proud that you don't need the guidance of the Spirit when you study the Word of God because you have studied theology, you have a degree in, you know, the Bible, that you have a PhD degree, you don't need God there. You have a problem there. And you need to be processed if that is your choice. But I hope no one will choose that. Number two, I somewhat need the Bible. Number three, I neither need the Bible, neutral in other words. Not very sure if you need the Bible in times like this when COVID-19 came. Still around. What's the use of the Bible? Can we use the Bible to kill the germs or the virus? Well, that statement simply indicates he does not understand the significance of the Bible in our time. See, the virus cannot be seen by our naked eyes. It's just around. And according to experts, they now conclude that the virus is airborne. In other words, it's transmitted not just by droplets or touch, but it's in the air. That's why it's mandated that we need to have a face mask. We don't have available face mask being sold. What we have are just ordinary cloth, and according to spirit, it's no use. The virus can get inside our nose. We need the surgical mask. But there, number four, I need the Bible. Okay, I think that is a good choice. We need the Bible, understand God's will for us this time. And of course, number five, I greatly need the Bible. Okay, so I hope you choose from 1 to 5, okay? There is no problem with 4 and 5. But if you are in 1 to 3, there needs to be processing. You need to ask church members when you come to church or you yourself in your home, what brought you there? And then ask the second question, what will you do to increase your number so that you will greatly need the Bible? So I hope that we understand our study tonight, the parallel of the Bible. The implication is that Jesus and the Bible are of divine origin. When we approach it with limited mind, we need the attitude of being in need or in need of something because we lack wisdom and understanding. And therefore, it's important that we approach it. So we explore this word need that includes our physical need for protection, healing, and all other basic needs to survive in times of crisis. Our Father in Heaven, thank you for the enlightenment of the Spirit tonight. Continue to create in us deep interest of the study of your word and cultivate in us attitude of approaching the Bible because our thoughts, our understanding is limited. Your concepts, your word are in. Thank you that you will reveal to us what we need in our time. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.